Did you? Sorry, I have to open up my script. Was the sound thing figured out from my video? Okay. Well, we'll see.
You're just gonna wanna full screen it and make sure that the computer itself has audio on, and then hit him up there will may be able to make sure that there's audio. No worries.
Okay.
All right.
Okay. Those of you who were at Pep Chapel, our last Pep Chapel, will remember the incredible film that that Yoav de Laroque shared with us, with the football team and the cheerleaders. I know he's changed his title a little bit from the one that we had before, but Creating Value in the World of Film. Yoav de Laroque, please take it away.
All right. Creating Value in the World of Film. I'm going to start off with another video, actually.
So crazy right now. I look this stuff so deep in your eyes. Touch you more and more every time. When you leave, I'm begging you not to go. Call your name 2-3 times in a row. Such a funny thing for me to try to explain.
Hello, fellow students and teachers. What you just watched is a video I made for Flag Football that St. Jay hosted. Creating motivating, attention-grabbing films like what you just watched and will someday see for me is something that I've always been interested in. Today, I will share my journey of being a filmmaker and what my future hopefully looks like. Oh. All right. So, what does the whole film scene look like? Well, let me explain. So, you have no money. This is where people start. They probably know where they want to begin and what their skills and where they could shine. So, how do you make videos and turn what you love into money? Well, simply put, you have to start. Start creating. Your videos are bad and could be better. They have no plot, terrible angles, bad lighting, no views, no likes. So you do some research. You hear the word composition. Consider what you're filming to be at least relevant. It's Saturday and you posted. 30 minutes later, you pick up your phone and see thousands of views. You even got some likes on your video. You're making steps and you've had a small taste of victory. Now you want to post more and more. You research other content creators. All these creators have excellent cameras and expensive setups, and their videos are getting incredible statistics. So you invest in gear until you're broke. Convince yourself that this is the only way that your likes will increase and your channel will get better statistics. Now you realize it's not that simple, and now you're broke. The more significant takeaway is now you'll understand that you will make mistakes, and that's how everything goes in the film world. 2 months later, with dedicated time, you're averaging consistently high views and high likes. You've decided what you want to film is cars. You love cars, and your community on social media likes your car content. You're ready for your investments from earlier to come back around. Ask someone you know who has a nice car if they want a video. They pay good money for the car, so chances are they'll want to show it off. And what better way than posting a 30-second video of it on social media in front of thousands of car enthusiasts? So now you're finally taking off. You're networking with car enthusiasts, advertising their cars, and making highlight reels for $100 each video. All your former investments in gear have come back around and you're profiting. All is well for your first 3 months of content creation. Now, I wish that's how it worked. That is the faulty dream every content creator has in the beginning. And most quit early because it was nothing like they believed it would be. So how is it going for me? Like the video I showed earlier, I've dipped a toe into sports creation that will turn into many years of building that skill. Since I was young, I have loved making films like about sports like hockey, biking, skiing, etc. When I was 10, I simply strung together videos with catchy soundtracks and posted them to my little YouTube channel, which was private, with one follower being my mom. Being oblivious to this, I created more and more videos of whatever I could find. This is how I developed a passion for filmmaking. I also loved watching movies. I loved the emotion and backstory behind these characters, and the way the hair stood up on my arms when in a tight situation, or how I bonded with the characters. I will come back to why this is instrumental in my filmmaking later. But for now, last year I decided to take out my phone. Without knowing what I was doing, I started taking iPhone clips of hockey because I was recently inspired by a YouTube channel named DeFi Productions. DeFi, directed by an international award winner, Brad Day, creates new dimensions to films by delivering superior, detailed motor knowledge. Brad Day is involved in cars and uses his understanding of cars and his skill in the movie to magnify the equipment and modifications to the vehicles to create innovative footage. DeFi, inspiring me, gave me eyes to film not just for action, not just for cars, but to connect film and people's emotion and people's passion. When I filmed these players, it was like a glimpse of their life or a door into their life. So what did I do with this newfound passion? I wanted to keep creating. I saw the light at the end of the tunnel. So I showed this video to people. I wanted to see what I ultimately saw. So I set up an Instagram account called The Rocks Media, where I'd post these hockey videos. This is where I planned to make a business. The problem that I faced is I'm a 17-year-old student. Creating a professional filmmaking business is daunting, especially building a sense of trust and responsibility from the people I'm filming. It is a challenge when they don't see what I see. Coming to sports events and being the younger at the time with an iPhone, while everyone had bigger shoulder cameras, was scary, and I admit, it was a little embarrassing. The money and logistics are also a big task, handling the expenses of camera gear, asking for money for the videos, and replacing parts that get broken or damaged are all valid issues that could happen. A video business at 17 also comes with more unique set of challenges, like inexperience in the field. When I started my journey as a young videographer, I would watch not just DeFi's films, but also YouTube creator Peter McKinnon for inspiration and their stories. Peter McKinnon, a YouTuber, started his journey as a freelance photographer and videographer. He began when social media hadn't quite taken off yet, so he created publicity through advertisements. This is an incredible challenge. The jump you have to make from nothing to making videos for a multi-million dollar companies is massive. And I think content creators take this for granted because they can post a video to social media like TikTok or Instagram and have excellent odds of it going viral with only some criteria met. At first, Peter went to any performance he could and took the videos of performers. After editing them, he emailed them back to the artist without guarantee that he would receive an email back. And guess what? 34 of those emails still go untouched by the creator, or maybe they were quickly disregarded. The point is that it's 34 different events. 34 videos were edited. I estimate that he probably shot maybe 50 videos for each performance. That comes out to be 1,700 videos taken, which is some crazy diligence. He didn't even start YouTube until 2015. Initially, he only started the channel to share his YouTube knowledge and experience of his journey with fellow photographers and filmmakers. Watching professionals like him grow so confidently gave me hope, but I couldn't help but notice the glaring gap in experience between me and the seasoned professionals in the industry. I was just starting while they had years of dedicated work under their belts and understood what truly shapes a captivating and compelling content is talent, dedication, time invested. So why did I even start if it's so difficult? Take college soccer, for instance. In soccer, how they pick and choose players has changed. Recruiters used to look at mostly physical traits, but now they pay attention to players' mental strength, namely, if they can handle the pressure of playing at a high level. They consider where a player comes from, because sometimes smaller communities provide better environment for developing athletes due to closer bonds with community, players, and coaches. Now, there are recruitment organizations that make this easier. These recruit for these recruiters. The National Collegiate Scouting Association, NCSA, is a private organization that helps student athletes to connect with colleges and coaches. Here's a simple overview of how NCSA works. NCSA provides a platform for student athletes to create online profiles showcasing their academic and athletic achievements. These profiles include key information such as firm statistics, academic achievements, video highlights, and more. NCSA may organize or promote events and recruiting combines where student athletes can showcase their talents to colleges and coaches. It's important to note, while NCSA can be a valuable resource for many student athletes and coaches, their recruiting is flawed for the people who don't have access to NCSA. According to studies from Tanya R. and Vincent J. Roskin, researchers of NCAA, financial constraints can pose a significant challenge for talented athletes in smaller countries who aspire to be recruited for college and sports in the United States or other colleges. Families with limited financial means may need help accessing the resources to promote their athletes effectively. This could include creating high-quality sports videos, attending showcases and tournaments, and participating in events that increase visibility to colleges. The NCAA has specific eligibility requirements for student athletes to participate in college sports. Visibility is crucial in the recruitment process, and those without means to participate in various events may miss out on potential opportunities. Understanding and navigating these requirements can be complex, and families Understanding and navigating these requirements can be complex, and families with financial means may need more support to access necessary guidance and support. While athletic scholarships may be available, there's often intense competition for these awards. Athletes from smaller countries may find it challenging to secure scholarships, particularly if they need more financial resources to engage in extensive recruitment efforts. During a phone call, I arranged with Peter Sorelles, a professional filmmaker in Toronto, Canada. This issue became abundantly clear. It was indeed a problem and a significant aspect of the athletic world. Peter shared a quick story of his friend Austin, an exceptionally talented 16-year-old golfer. However, Austin's potential was slowed due to financial constraints, making the idea of a professional career seem daunting. In response, as a friend, Peter took matters into his own hands by creating videos of Austin and sharing them online. Remarkably, within a year, Austin secured sponsorships that would let him turn professional and start a career of success. These sponsors covered all of his traveling expenses and pro expenses. That's where I stand with a goal in film and where I wish to pursue it. I hope to remind people that players from less media-covered regions can excel and attract college attention by making the most of their local opportunities. Someday, I wish to create a more precise platform and organization in the film for countries and groups of people with less money or no connection to reach collegiate or D1 level. At this point, you've heard about my excitement and dedication. You know how I became passionate about this medium, and I have shown you that there is a need for this type of work. No matter how much I love this, there are certainly barriers besides my age that make this a challenging dream. For example, I must remember that I need to get into college, proving that smaller steps will lead to big steps in the future. I plan to email the business house at St. Jay requesting a job or media coverage. This job would be similar to the current position of the school photographer, Mr. Leggy, but I strive to look at video needs, mostly on sports. Later in college, I want to film for college teams while consistently posting tips and my journey like Peter McKinnon. So, if I could leave you with a simple but personal connection to filmmaking, it is not always the quality of the videos or the money you make from it. Ultimately, the reaction from people who have been burning out and losing interest in a sport they always loved, and the smiles they give when they see themselves in a video highlighting their sports, or hearing them talk about sending it in on their resume to college or teams. For me, that is better than any money or social media popularity. Thank you. I didn't realize that it wasn't in full screen mode.
Sorry.
Like halfway through. Yeah. Sorry.
It's okay. Thank you. Yeah. Questions for Yofta?
I'm just wondering, have you considered going to film school?
I think filming for colleges and sports is something that I want to pursue on my own because it's such an opinion kind of job for me. I don't really think for me being taught through how to film for people is something that I want to do.
If If you like wanted to get like a video camera, do you have any like ideas on what kind to get?
If you're just starting out, your phone is fine. That's how I started.
My phone is blurry.
Pardon?
My phone gets really blurry and doesn't know how to focus.
Oh, I think then maybe a phone replacement would be better than looking for a camera.
Other questions?
Just out of curiosity, how long did it take? Does it take you to like get the clips and edit a video, such as the football one you did at the beginning of the year?
I'd say for the editing process, it's about like 45 minutes, depending on what it's for. If it's for a long form content like YouTube, it probably takes longer than a short 10-second video for TikTok. The video shooting, though, I don't pay attention to that. I love it so much that it's really not a concern.
So when you start doing this like as work, do you want to stick to your own style when it comes to like editing, or are you going to like take requests like by whoever you're working for like the editing style?
Definitely requests. I do want to do stuff on my own, but requests, and people have a certain way they want things filmed, and they want themselves or companies to advertise things. So taking requests is always a good.
So when it's all said and done, is there a certain sport that you'd rather film for? Like some professional sports teams hire videographers. Is there a certain sport that you would like to indulge in more than another?
Yes, I really do like high action sports like biking or skiing, but also any sport like football and pro level that has the atmosphere of high intensity. You want me to say basketball? Basketball is cool too. I don't like it as much though.
Mr. McKenzie.
I think it's really admirable that you want to help athletes who might not otherwise have the potential to move forward. Do you see that as just an avocation, something you want to do on the side without financial benefit, or have you thought about any ways that you might be able to make a living doing that?
So this is really, I mostly went in detail about what the next maybe 5 years look for me, but the dream that I really want to pursue someday is creating maybe it's a company with 100 people who go out to remote locations or remote countries and find players that excel and then highlight their activities and then get them to where they can excel best. Probably like fundraisers for colleges. I know a lot of people, if this was presented as a bigger thing, I'm pretty sure people would be on board with that. So I think, and sponsors, definitely. There are definitely a lot of sponsors that would do that.
Other questions for Yafta? Yafta, have you actually filmed somebody and have they used it for a college scholarship or acceptance? Have you experienced that yet?
For colleges, no.
Have you made a recruiting film for anyone?
So here, one of my favorite films, it's not the football one I showed in Pep Chapel or the dodgeball one. It's a day when my coach told me he asked me to come out and film iPhone clips with him for a sponsor that he had. And I told him that I had a camera and that I was really excited to use it. And he said, no, I don't really want to mess up these video clips, or like, I don't want to take too much time out here. So we took about 70 clips. At the end though, there was one jump line, and I asked if I could get out my camera for those, and he said, yeah. And I ended up making a video with maybe 4 specific videos out of that. The company ended up using my video than the other videos that he sent to them. So. That's my favorite.
Excellent. It sounds like you'd have a good proposal to make for a nonprofit. Any other questions for Yafta? Congratulations, Yafta. Thank you for joining us.